exotic Micronesia in the Western Pacific. About 500 miles east of the Philippines, 3,000 islands and atolls, which include the Carolines. And in the Carolines, near the equator, more than 300 emerald-green islands, won by the United States in World War II, an archipelago called Palau. Hi, I'm George Page, and many Americans have never heard of the Palau Islands. Although they became the independent Republic of Belau in 1980, the islands, population 15,000, are still a mandated territory of the United States, one of several American outposts in the Pacific. Surrounded by a vast barrier reef, the islands were formed by volcanoes 20 million years ago. Today, they contain some of the strangest and most varied marine environments on Earth. Our filmmakers, Paul Atkins and Michael DeGree, along with producer Keenan Smart, had to avoid poison trees, treacherous currents, and saltwater crocodiles to make our film about Palau. Fortunately, they survived, and we can now share their adventure.
In the darkness of the deep, Medusa, daughter of the ancient sea gods, queen of jellyfish, swims through an abyss of danger. Her fate, to fall into the deadly embrace of a sea anemone. Caught in the snaky locks, she succumbs to its smothering hold. One gargantuan swallow, she vanishes. But even within the anemone, Medusa's body still trembles in a slow death. Our story begins in an underworld of primeval chaos, an apparently infernal realm in the depths of a mysterious lake in the heart of the Pacific. Strange waters that boil with an astonishing multitude of jellyfish. They rise from the depths, shimmering phantoms throbbing toward the surface. But all these jellyfish are prisoners. Millions of them, confined within a barrier of rock and trees. Their home is a lost lake marooned within an island, cut off from the surrounding tropical sea by a wall of jungle-covered limestone, built up over centuries by corals. This is Palau, a long string of islands scattered in the middle of Micronesia. It's a Pacific paradise, about 2,000 miles south of Japan. Palau was born 70 million years ago in the fire of ancient undersea volcanoes. Many of the original volcanic islands sank slowly back into the sea, with reefs of coral clinging to their edges. Remnants of those ancient reefs were then heaved out of the ocean by earthquakes. Carved by sea and weather, they now form a profusion of escarpments, jagged ridges, and mushroom-shaped pedestals. Nestling close to the equator, Palau is a hot, humid greenhouse. Trees sprout and flourish from a bed of limestone riddled by a labyrinth of fissures and crevices. In places, collapsed walls and tunnels provide breaks in the ramparts. Through these channels, the sea flows to form marine lakes. There are more than 80 marine lakes in Palau's limestone landscape, each with its own peculiar mixture of inhabitants. Many lakes with wide access to the sea harbor sharks and saltwater crocodiles. In others, narrow entrances prohibit entry of such large animals, and the residents swarm undisturbed. By far the most bizarre is Jellyfish Lake, which appears to have no direct connection to the sea at all. These creatures are both farmers and sun worshippers. Unlike many Medusae, they have no stinging tentacles and don't capture their own food. Instead, each one cultivates within its body tissues millions of tiny algae. The algae use the sun's energy to make food. To assist the plant guests, the Medusae must stay in the sunlight all day long. In return for that free transport and accommodation, the algae provide nourishment for their hosts. Since the jellyfish are light sensitive and strong swimmers, they can detect and steer clear of the shoreline's dark shadow. Being fragile, the jellyfish must stay away from these mangrove roots, a treacherous scaffolding protruding from the muddy compost of centuries of dead leaves. Colonized by seaweeds and sponges, the mangroves form a tangled underwater forest. Though landlocked, the lost world of Jellyfish Lake is extremely salty. Twice a day, tide water from the surrounding ocean slowly seeps through the porous limestone into this inland sea. Minute cracks and narrow tunnels in the rocks are the umbilical links, carrying in and out of the lake the eggs and larval stages of the organisms which live here. Although large enough for eggs and larvae, the fissures are too narrow for the mature jellyfish to swim through, nor can they be sucked out on an ebb tide. So the adults are trapped forever in their lake. Jellyfish are animals with a very simple nervous system, yet the behavior of this species reaches an astonishing level of complexity. Every day, millions of them follow a schedule to which you can set a watch. Each morning, they gather together and swim in the same direction from one side of the lake to the other, each with a single purpose, to get as much sunlight as possible for the algae lodging in their bodies. Not surprisingly, a few get shipwrecked. Adrift in the shallows, some risk tearing their soft bodies on sharp projections. But they face other dangers as well. Delicate anemones are an ever-present menace, ready to grab jellyfish which run aground in their vicinity. Once caught, there's little hope of pulling free. But it's not just anemones which benefit from jellyfish in distress. Marine snails are always on the lookout for a free meal and home in to pillage any wreck. With their sucking mouths, these mollusks draw in lumps of jelly. Muggers lie in ambush. These are hungry gobies. Torn and tattered, the jellyfish still show amazing resilience. They can even keep swimming with half their body chewed away. Jellyfish are a plentiful and vital item on the menu for the lake's other residents. Yet astonishingly, only three kinds of fish live here and reap the benefits of this bountiful food supply. Cardinal fish. No predators threaten them, and their behavior is calm and serene. Unlike their timid cousins of the open reef, these cardinals are unafraid. The goby's strong jaws easily break open mussels. Food for one is food for all, but competition at this dinner table is a gentle affair. Although many jellyfish victims lie dying in the wake of the passing swarm, most of this great mass evade fatal encounters. Stragglers often weave a path through the maze of obstacles. Despite the dangers and difficulties, most of the jellyfish accomplish their daily migration across the lake, swimming through the clear surface waters where sunlight is brightest. Darting between them, schools of silver sides. They're the lake's only other fish and feed on the rich soup of plankton. Of the many species of fish that could live here, only three have managed to adapt to this isolated world. Closeted behind the walls of limestone, the lifestyles of the lake's inhabitants have become quite different from their sea-dwelling relatives. Scientists have only recently discovered Jellyfish Lake. Much remains to be learned about life, both below and above this lost world. The green curtain hanging by the lakeside stretches overland to the nearby ocean. To reach the sea, a traveler on foot must plunge into mangrove swamps, scramble over razor-sharp coral rubble, and brush past jungle trees that bleed poisonous sap, a sap so corrosive that it can burn and blister skin and eyes. Insects are most at home here. They're food for the fan-tailed flycatcher. Spiders lurk patiently, waiting for a meal. Wasps tend their brood in carefully crafted nests built underneath leaves. A single egg is laid in each hexagonal cell. Around the marine lake, breezes are always gentle. Beyond the distant ridge, howling gales may sweep the reef, but within the protection of the steep forested slopes, only a few light cat's paws play across the water surface. Tropical rainstorms drench Palau almost every day of the year. Because there's a lack of wind and waves, fresh rainwater on the surface doesn't mix with the salty layers below. The lake is not stirred up, so its waters stay stable and in discrete layers. Here, in the more turbulent sea, less than half a mile away, half-beaks take the place of jellyfish. They cruise just beneath rain-splashed waves. The squalls which sweep over the islands shroud them in mist and unleash tremendous quantities of rain. So frequent are the downpours, many creatures choose to ride out each deluge rather than seek shelter. Slowed down by a cool shower, a lizard simply lets rain slide off its back. Built like a tank, the rhinoceros beetle has armor plating that's watertight. Raindrops percolate down through the canopy of leaves, soaking the forest floor. Here, humic acids, generated by decaying vegetation, leach into the soil, trickling through pores and dissolving the limestone. In this way, the bedrock is further eroded and riddled with holes. In the aftermath of torrential rainstorms, birds flock to feed on seeds exposed by the force of the rain. Chestnut manakins are highly social and interact constantly. Others, like this rail, take the opportunity of a quick bath in a temporary pool. The encircling sea dominates Palau. These waters are the richest in the entire Pacific. Squid patrol the open water. Perhaps the most advanced soft-bodied animals in the ocean, they signal one another by flashing color patterns over their skin. Jet-powered hunters, squid force water through a nozzle under their heads and can travel at high speed. Terns keep a weather eye open for the commotion caused by a feeding frenzy. Only the onset of darkness will bring the tern's fishing forays to an end. At night, on the reef, most corals extend their stinging tentacles to feed on small planktonic animals drifting by. Corals are the creatures which built Palau, but these are soft corals. Hard corals secrete an external skeleton of calcium carbonate into which they can withdraw. Nocturnal shrimps haunt the reef. The transparent body of this living specter acts like a high-powered lens. It actually magnifies the background, perhaps confusing a predator. Many reef fish seek shelter at night, but nooks and crannies are carefully guarded by the tenants already there. Butterfly perch swim in schools, feeding on plankton. They stick close within a territory by day and night. When sleepy, they yawn and retire to coral crevices. But while some turn in, other creatures are getting ready to work the night shift. The cone shell, a dangerous relative of the humble garden snail, is a deadly night prowler. As the cone glides over coral rubble, it senses the whereabouts of sleeping fish by drawing in water through a tube protruding from its head. Near prey, it snakes out a poison-tipped harpoon in anticipation. A sinister, expandable mouth completes the portrait of a highly proficient killer. The final attack is guided by touch and stealth. Suddenly, the barbed harpoon is driven hard into the unsuspecting fish. Immediately, the grotesque mouth opens wide to consume it. Once hooked, the fish is doomed. Muscular paralysis is almost immediate as the cone shell's poison rapidly attacks the nervous system. Only the gills continue to pump forlornly as the victim is engulfed. Swallowing and digesting such a meal may last several hours, a dangerous period for the monstrous snail, as its stretched and bloated body cannot be withdrawn completely under its protective shell. Possessing such a deadly toxin, one might imagine that the cone has little to fear from assailants. But another type of cone shell is a specialist in the art of detecting and destroying its close relatives. Like some futuristic war machine, it zeroes in on a target. Such encounters have an inevitable outcome. On contact with its quarry, the assassin's lethal weaponry is released. As it searches, traces of venom float from the harpoon tip. Like a dancing serpent, it seeks a vulnerable spot on the pinioned prey. There, the sting is thrust home, but one injection may not be sufficient to paralyze its adversary completely. Another dose is required. Cautiously, it explores once more. Finally, with a clinical caress, the needle tenses and jabs. It could kill you, too. In a few hours, a cleaned out, empty shell will be all that remains. Just one more piece of debris in the recesses of the reef. Dawn filters into a coral cavern. Reef corals thrive only where the sea temperatures average at least 68 degrees Fahrenheit all year round. Over 300 species have been found in Palau, four times more than are known from the very rich Caribbean Sea. Their variety is astonishing, but only the outer coating of this edifice is alive. The interior is composed of a dead skeleton of solid coral limestone, compressed and inert. Living corals are nourished by what drifts by from the surrounding sea. Butterfly fish feed along the seaward face where the reef drops off precipitously. Only a few miles away, the ocean is almost as deep as Mount Everest is high. Parrotfish browse the hard corals, their powerful beak-like mouths scraping off chunks of food. They erode the corals with their bites. Parrotfish play a role in breaking down and recycling the living reef. Undigested fragments of coral are expelled in thick clouds, which slowly settle, creating sandy patches where other creatures can live. Sometimes great armies of fish attack the expanse of coral. Solitary fish run many risks. Each must keep a wary eye for danger. But without knowing it, the watchers themselves may be watched. Thank you. a scorpion fish is ready to strike. In a cloak of many colors, a sea hare browses the surface of the coral. Decorative plumes sprout from the back of a Spanish dancer. They act as gills for this colorful sea slug. It too finds food underfoot. This one carries a permanent passenger, a shrimp, which spends its life crawling over its companion and feeding on bits of flaking skin and leftovers from meals. Carpets of anemones billow in the surge. Hidden among their poisonous tentacles are tiny clownfish, immune to their sting. Clownfish prepare nests in a cleared area near their protective anemone. They carefully tend their eggs, which they've stuck to the rock, and maintain a flow of oxygen-rich water around them. Cuttlefish hover around coral heads, prepared at any time to assume one of their innumerable disguises. Healthy corals are normally free from contaminating seaweeds, but dead or damaged colonies soon become matted with a thick coating of algae. These lawns provide a rich source of food for many grazing fish. Some fish deliberately damage living coral branches to encourage the growth of weed. This damselfish cultivates patches here and there, carefully tending its farm and cropping algae when hungry. As residents, they're highly aggressive and protective of their territory. Trespassers are vigorously attacked. But surgeon fish have adopted a mass marauding strategy to challenge those defenses. Although confronted with such large shoals, a single tenacious damselfish may still succeed in heading them off. But sheer force of numbers can eventually pay off for the surgeon fish. They overwhelm the defenders, sweeping down to feed frantically before moving on. Thank you. Palau's remarkable reefs first came to the attention of Europeans in 1783, when the trading ship Antelope, outward bound from Macau in China, was blown off course by a typhoon and wrecked among this mosaic of islands. On the Navy's charts, there later appeared Palau. It lies on top of a submerged chain of volcanic mountain peaks, now known as the Kyushu Ridge, extending from Japan to Papua New Guinea. Changes in sea level and great earth movements lifted the ancient reefs hundreds of feet into the air. Then new coral growths fringed the islands. The marine lakes were created when rising sea levels flooded hollows and caverns. When the sea retreated, the lakes remained. Wherever boulders tossed by waves accumulate, sand piles up to form coral strands. These beaches are soon colonized. A root hole can be found even in naked rock. Where the forest has established itself, somehow animals have managed to follow. Butterflies fly in and gather at a favorite food plant to feed and court. But where did this millipede come from? Perhaps from eggs rafted in on driftwood. It's a millipede of giant proportions. Here, many insects are jumbo-sized. These plant bugs cluster among stems, sucking sap. Each female lays her eggs in a tight bunch beneath leaves. The praying mantis is always a threat to the young. When they hatch, the young bugs herd together beneath their mother for protection. Straying away from the crowd invites attack. Given a chance, the mantis will even grab armfuls of baby bugs. This alarmed mother is too big for the mantis. She does her best to scare it away from her brood, kicking out in threat. Deeper in the jungle, limestone precipices are pockmarked with chambers, but animals have found their way here too. In these dark caverns, there are troglodytes, cave crickets. They communicate by touch. Cave crickets have little need for eyes. In the darkness, their enormous antennae constantly explore the rocky wall, stroking their neighbors and guiding the crickets through the blackness. Whip scorpions, the width of a dinner plate, creep around crevices, but are careful to avoid bumping into other cave dwellers. Swiftlets have successfully taken to life underground, although they must still leave their caves to hunt flying insects above the jungle canopy. Like bats, they've evolved a technique of using sounds to find their way about and avoid bumping into cave walls. But bats use high-frequency calls inaudible to our ears. Swiftlets generate a series of loud, penetrating clicks, which echo around and locate any obstacles in this natural cathedral. The forest entrance is some 300 feet above. Below, the deepest level of the cave is reached through a series of smaller and smaller chambers. Farther down the grotto, bats outnumber swiftlets. As it gets deeper, the cave becomes damper. Water trickling down from the forest above drips off stalactites. And at the very bottom, a pond. But remarkably, this pool is brackish and tidal. The rising or falling water makes strange sounds as it flows along the rocky plumbing connecting it with the nearby sea. No fish swim here, yet the sea is only about 6 feet away. Limestone overhangs, sculpted by waves, dissolved by rain, and eroded by the grazing and boring shellfish and sponges. A venturesome lizard, predator or prey. It's too big for the venomous sea snakes, which shelter and rest on the rock ledges. This one feeds mainly on small fish and eels. Tunnels, caves, reefs, and lakes are all interconnected. They're part of a huge arterial network spreading through the limestone of Palau. The ocean's ceaseless movement is Palau's pumping heart. Currents and tides carry nutrients and new life to every corner, and with the same pulse, flush it clean. Thank you. Each marine lake has its own special character. Some have lettuce corals flourishing near their entrance. Others seem almost barren. But of all these landlocked seas, none is more dramatic than Jellyfish Lake. Here too lives the majestic moon jellyfish Aurelia. The Medusa of Greek mythology turned to stone all who gazed upon her. It's strangely appropriate these jellyfish are themselves imprisoned within Palau's limestone walls. But the secret of the jellyfish's survival here lies deep in the lake. The calm waters never mix, but instead form turbid layers. Surface waters contain plenty of oxygen, but lower down there exists a peculiar chemical cauldron where clouds of bacteria attack and decompose dead animals and plants sinking into the lake. There's little oxygen here, but the bacteria don't need it anyway. In places, they teem in such numbers that pigment in their bodies colors the water red. In this primordial soup, the breakdown of dead tissue produces gases toxic to oxygen breathers. But the algae cultivated within the jellyfish need nitrogen to grow. It's abundant in these depths. So each night, their day-long tracking of the sun at an end, the jellyfish dive deep into the lake, soaking up vital nitrogen fertilizer for their crop of algae. In this perpetual journey lies the key to the survival of the Medusa. The fate of each is sealed. They must wander forever through this underworld bounded by stone.